and a hush comes over the room. Are you ready? How many of you are from Chris Rausch's business journalism class? Higher, put that up. You're gonna get a degree in business journalism. Okay, how many of you are in 153 classes this semester? Well, let's hear it for 153. That's fantastic, okay. Now, I'm Susan King. I'm the Dean of the School of Journalism and Mass Communication. I just realized I don't teach 153, so you may not know that. But I have traveled all over the country meeting with alums, and they will all talk about it, no matter whether they were the class from 1952, or the class from 1966, or the class in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and the 2000s. And they say, I hated 153, and it was the best class I ever took. So I want you to remember that tonight. My favorite story is, I will quote, because I'm a good reporter, Jeff Eisenberg, who's an account executive at Google now. He started in New York. He's now out in San Francisco. And he said, I was an advertising major. I kept saying, why do I have to take 153? He said, I've moved up beyond all my other colleagues because I can write the best strategy memo. So no matter what you're doing, good writing is going to get you there. And so that's what this is all about. I want you to know that you're here to hear one of the preeminent editors-in-chief at one of America, in fact, the global brands. The Wall Street Journal is clearly one of the great newspapers of the world, but it is so much more than that because it's a global brand. It is on all platforms, and it has a huge audience. I'm not going to tell you all about that because the editor-in-chief, Jerry Boyd, is going to be telling you about that. What I want to tell you about is why Nelson Benton would be so happy tonight. Now, this is the Nelson Benton Lecture Series, and I'm sure, does anyone here know who Nelson Benton is? Yep, but you don't count, Winston. That's a professor. That's why I'm here to tell you. He is a graduate of UNC, and he was a great CBS correspondent in the golden age of Walter Cronkite News. And his son is also a journalist. And when his dad died, he said, I want to give something back to UNC. And he got lots of executives and news folks at CBS to donate so we could have this series every year in his memory. And I think that Nelson Benton would have loved the fact that we have Gerard Baker, the editor-in-chief, at this lecture that was named after him. And here's why. Nelson Benton was the epitome of the South. I knew when he was a correspondent in Washington, and he had that kind of drawl. He just had that easy way about him, and he spoke not that Middle Eastern, Middle West kind of English. He spoke with a Southern accent. He graduated from UNC in the 40s, and he made his name as a newspaper man. Then he went to CBS TV News, which was the premier television broadcast of its day. And he covered the South, the home that he loved. And that's part of why he became a person that CBS wanted to hire, because he chronicled the civil rights era and the movement that was just roiling the country and, in fact, changed the United States. Benton was a Southerner always and a newsman forever. Gerard Baker is a Brit. You'll hear that when he starts talking. He grew up in England. And he began work the opposite. He was a TV guy. He was a newsman, a producer. He was working for the BBC. Now he's a newspaper man leading one of the world's great news organizations from the very top. But it is so much more, as I said. It is a digital enterprise. It does TVs and documentary work. All of that is part of the Wall Street Journal brand. And Nelson Benton would have loved that Jerry was doing this because Baker is proof that a TV guy can run a news organization. And that even if you move from your home turf, where you're most comfortable, the South for Benton, or England for Baker, you never lose your accent. I think you're in for an exciting evening. A look inside the Wall Street Journal and a look inside business journalism. You're also going to have a panel with one of our top professors here at UNC, who I'll introduce you to just after these opening remarks, and two of your fellow students, who, if they do their job well, will grill our editor-in-chief tonight. Because if he gives it, We know he can take it. So I hope you will put your hands together for a warm welcome for our speaker, our Nelson Benton Lecture speaker, Jerry Baker.
Thank you very much indeed, Dean King. That was very, very kind of you. I have no idea what 153 is, but all I know is I want to enroll for it immediately. I obviously need that kind of education, which I didn't get where I studied. Thank you very much again for having me. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's a great pleasure to be in this the great state. It's a particular pleasure to be here at this very distinguished university and this very distinguished school. Produced many, many great journalists over the years, I'm glad to say. Many of them actually at my own newspaper, The Wall Street Journal, including a former editor, subject of a book that Dean Rausch has written about, and I look forward to reading more about that. So it's a pleasure to be here and to talk to you a little bit about the nature of business journalism, the history of business journalism, and I hope the future of business journalism, because despite what some of you may have read in some parts of the press or elsewhere, I think business journalism actually does have a very strong future, but I think it's going to be different from the kind of journalism that that we've seen over the last 100 years or so. As Dean King said, you can tell from my accent that I don't come from around here. I did actually grow up in England, left there more than 25 years ago. But I'm often asked when I speak to events, when I speak to people in the United States, and they hear that I'm the editor-in-chief of the Wall Street Journal, and then they hear my accent, and there's a bit of a disconnect. They think, what's going on? You know, how does a Brit get to be editor of the Wall Street Journal? Surely that's not quite right. I thought we threw you guys out of here 240 years ago or whatever it was. And yeah, well, you did, it's true. And you know, we've shown, though, I think, that you can't keep a good nation down. And I think what we've learned, what we've demonstrated as the British, I'm afraid, over a long period of time, is that even though we're no longer perhaps the great nation, the dominant nation that we once were, I think unfortunately, the British perhaps still have a bit of a tendency to think of themselves as actually exercising a little bit more power in the world than they really do, and that's why people end up in positions like this. To show as an illustration of how much perhaps self-regard the British have, I'll tell you one of my favorite jokes, and I apologize if you've heard it before, but it's a joke which goes very much to explain the way in which the British, particularly the British Prime Minister of the day, regards himself or themselves. And it goes like this: one day God calls down from heaven, and he calls on President Obama, President Xi Jinping of China, and Prime Minister David Cameron from Britain. And he calls them up to heaven and he says, I've got very important news for you. You've got to go back and tell your people about it. The world is going to end tomorrow. So President Obama goes back to Washington, goes on national television and says, I've got good news and bad news. The good news is there is a God, and we devout, religious, God-fearing Americans have been right about that all along. The bad news is I've met him, and he's told me the world's going to end tomorrow and we have to get ready for it. President Xi Jinping goes back to Beijing, goes on national television, and says to the Chinese people, I've got bad news and frankly even worse news. The bad news is there is a God, and we Chinese atheists, communists have been wrong about that all along. And the worst news is I've met him and he's told me the world's going to end tomorrow and we have to get ready for it. Prime Minister David Cameron goes back to Britain, goes on national television, and says to the British people, great news. God considers me to be one of the three most important people in the world. So forgive me if I convey a little bit of that rather outmoded British self-importance. I'm going to talk a bit about business journalism. I look very forward very much to discussing with the students, my fellow panelists up here in a bit. But I thought I'd just set out for you a little bit, as I say, what I think has been happening to business journalism and what I think the future is. It's a very auspicious year, auspicious time for me to be talking about this. As you probably know, I hope you know, I don't know how many of you are subscribers to the Wall Street Journal. I hope many of you at least read the Wall Street Journal on a regular basis. If you don't, I can happily arrange for you to take out a subscription later today. But the Wall Street Journal this year is celebrating we're celebrating our 125th anniversary. We were founded in 1889 by Charles Dow and Edward Jones, whose names, as you know, became synonymous with financial journalism for a very long time. And the circumstances in which they established the Wall Street Journal on July the 8th, 1889, were not actually dramatically dissimilar to the circumstances we find ourselves in today. There was a lot of financial news and information about. The American economy, as you know, was going through a period of considerable growth. The world economy was globalizing rapidly. There was much considerable integration of business and capital and labor. There was a lot of excitement, a lot of investment, a lot of investment opportunities. The joint stock company had been founded sometime more than 100 years before that, and investment was in those companies was growing dramatically. But unfortunately, a lot of the information that people had with which to invest, on the basis of which to invest, was not very reliable. A lot of it was very, very one-sided, opinionated. A lot of it was very promotional, what we would think of today as kind of public relations, companies promoting themselves in an effort to get people to buy their stock or to buy their products. A lot of it was, frankly, made up. A lot of it was not very widely disseminated. It was a very uneven market, a very uneven field for financial information. Charles Dow and Edward Jones decided that they wanted to establish a newspaper, a news organization, that would cut through that, cut through the bias and the unreliability and the public relations, and offer news, pure and simple, which they believe to be objective facts. I'll give you a quote that when the very first issue of the Wall Street Journal, published 125 years ago this year, contained a quote from them as they launched it. It said, "The journal will aim steadily at being a paper of news and not a paper of opinions. It will give a picture of news not found in other news in other publications, and it will present in the market articles its news, its tables, and its advertisements a faithful picture of the rapidly evolving panorama of the street." And again, as I say, the importance of that was much of the news around then, around that time, wasn't very reliable. Again, you look at the situation we're in today, 125 years later, and you could say much the same thing. A lot of the news since, especially in the last 20 years, is we've had a dramatic expansion of sources of information. There is much more information available now if you're in financial business or indeed in any kind of business. But it's not necessarily reliable. A lot of it is opinion masked as news. A lot of it is promotional material masked as news. And so the virtues, the values that the Wall Street Journal were founded on, I believe are as relevant today, 125 years later, as they were back then in 1889. And I think the journal has worked very hard to remain faithful to those values of its founders over 125 years. Business journalism, of course, then, with the founding of the Wall Street Journal, really grew very rapidly in the United States. Other news organizations followed, and regular news, the main news organizations, began to cover business too as it became more and more important. But I have to say, for the first 100 years, right up until the 1980s, business journalism was, to be really honest, regarded as a bit of the rather second-class citizens to the main business of journalism. I started out in journalism almost 30 years ago. As Dean King said, I worked for the BBC. And in those days, back in the 1980s, the really glamorous stuff was the war reporting and the political reporting. To be honest with you, if you did business journalism, you were regarded as a bit of a geek. And to be honest, people wondered, if you want to do business, why didn't you actually go into business rather than writing about it? You surely should, you know, you'd be much better off, you'd be paid better. Business journalism never had the glamour and the sex appeal that politics and war and celebrity news and entertainment news had. But I think in the last 25 years, to me, what's the most interesting about the history of business journalism, in the last 25 years, that has changed quite dramatically. Of course, people still are very attracted, journalists are still very attracted to covering politics and war and diplomacy and the big issues of politics and international relations of our time. But business and financial journalism has become extremely important and extremely high profile. Really beginning, I think, in the late 1980s, it really took off, grew in its importance and in its reach. For a number of reasons, I think partly the end of the Cold War after 1989 shifted attention away from the great ideological division, which was what informed so much of journalism and so much of newspaper and television and radio journalism in those days. We became less riven by those great ideological divides and focused more on the workings of what seemed to be the successful capitalist model. And so people became more interested in the way that business worked, the capital markets worked, the capitalist system worked. You also, I think, had what you've seen is this extraordinary explosion of financial assets. Beginning in the 1980s with the deregulation of financial markets, global financial assets grew at a phenomenal rate, an exponential rate, and actually, despite the crisis of the last few years, still are growing. Total financial assets in the world have grown sixfold in the last 25 years. They've gone from representing about a third of global GDP, of global total economic activity, to representing almost twice global GDP. The need to understand these financial assets, the need to understand where they're being invested, how they work, what the opportunities are, has become extremely important, not just for people who work in financial markets, but for everybody, everybody with a pension, everybody with a job who needs to understand where their investments are going, what they're going to be doing. That's become a hugely important source of demand for improved financial news and information. And the third big factor that's led to the growth of financial and business news and business journalism has been the extraordinary series of events that we've had. Many of the major events that we've seen in the world in the last 25 years, since the fall of the Berlin Wall, have actually been primarily financial events, extraordinary convulsive events that have changed the direction of the world, whether it was the European crisis of the early 1990s around the creation of the exchange rate mechanism of the European monetary system, whether it was the Asian financial crisis in 1997, which brought to its knees the rapidly growing economy, many of the rapidly growing economies of Asia, whether it was the collapse of the dot-com bubble in 2000 and what followed from that. Of course, whether it was, most importantly, the financial events of the last 5 years, or 5 years, 6 years ago, 2007, 2008, the financial crisis. These were extraordinarily important events that people needed to understand, that they were often very complex, rooted in very complex activities and trends, but people needed more than ever to understand what was going on. And so the hunger for financial information, for business journalism, for quality business journalism only grew. And so here we are, 25 years later, 125 years after the founding of the Wall Street Journal, where I would say that business journalism has never been more important. You have a growing global class of increasingly prosperous people around the world who need to know the way the global economy works, an increasingly interconnected global economy, interconnected in complex ways, people with access to huge amounts of financial assets, and people who are at the mercy sometimes of these extraordinary, apparently inexplicable, massive financial events that can crash an economy, that can bring us, as we saw 6 years ago, bring the global economy almost to the point of collapse. So the desire, of course, none of that is to say that the traditionally, other aspects of journalism are not important too. Of course, they're incredibly important. We still have wars, unfortunately. We still have politics. People still need to know those events too. But the relative importance of business journalism has grown dramatically in the last 25 years. And so this is a great moment for business journalism. This is a moment when all these people around the world need high quality, objective, analytical, fair, accurate information about what's going on in the world. It's an amazing opportunity for us who work in the financial sectors and in the sector of financial news, but it's an amazing opportunity for the world to find out about these important events. And if you look at the way in which people access financial information, financial news, that too represents a great opportunity. If you, obviously, the Wall Street Journal, again, founded 125 years ago, in 1996, we started a website. That has grown, as have all websites, as have all digital applications of all journalism, exponentially in the last 20 years. So we have something now, the audience for our journalism has grown dramatically. So in the past, before 1996, when the journal only really published a print edition, the maximum circulation of the Wall Street Journal was about 2.5 million. Now, every day, we get something, every month, we have something like 16 million unique visitors to Wall Street Journal journalism. in the course of a month, there are 121 million page views for our journalism. So, as you all know, you're all sitting there with your, most of you with your laptops open, you can access every single newspaper, every single news organization, everywhere in the world instantly. This has created an extraordinary global audience for journalism, and particular, as I say, given the circumstances we find ourselves in, for an audience, a hungry audience that wants better information about financial journalism. And we, along with other financial news organizations, are benefiting from that, and growing dramatically. But of course, there is, as the British like to say, there's a cloud to every silver lining, or there is salt to every strawberry, and that is the digital revolution itself has, of course, fundamentally changed in which journalism is practiced. And again, you know this better than I. You know the way in which the traditional way in which people access news has fundamentally changed as a result of the change in distribution. And I think the key thing here is what has fundamentally changed, and it's important to understand this and to understand why, even as business journalism faces this extraordinary opportunity to spread the word, to spread its news around the world, it faces also what many people see as a fundamental and existential crisis, like all journalism. The fundamental fact is that the model of business, the model of journalism generally, but the model of business journalism, which is sustained business journalism for the first 100 years, 125 years of its existence, has been fundamentally destroyed. And this should be a source of concern for all of us. Now, people talk about what are the challenges that, modern business journalism faces, and it's, and there are many challenges. Obviously, there are many more sources of news now. There are many more sources of competition. One particular challenge that I hear a lot of people complain about is, and I think there's some truth to this, that our job as business journalists, while our job is to tell the story, to explain what is going on with companies and with markets, and explain what's happening in the world, and to dig in and find out information that companies don't want to reveal. I mean, a large part of journalism, as somebody once said, journalism fundamentally is about the news is what people don't want published. Everything else is advertising. It's our job as journalists to find out information that is embarrassing to companies, embarrassing to governments, embarrassing to individuals, in order to let people know so they have a better means of understanding the way in which the companies and the economy works. It's an expensive business. We have to, in order to do that, we have to hire journalists. We have to hire journalists with great skills, people who understand the way companies work. If they don't have it, we have to train them. And we have to spend a lot of money and time as investigating, digging into stories, investigating scandals, investigating what may be going on which somebody doesn't want us to know. It's an expensive business. For the first 100 plus years of newspapers' existence, of the news business's existence, there was a very comfortable model which was able to sustain that expensive journalism, which was, of course, advertising. Every single news organization, unless they were publicly funded, depended very, very heavily on advertising. It was the way in which the way in which they got the vast bulk of their revenues. It was a very imperfect way of companies communicating to their customers. They would take out large advertisements in the Wall Street Journal or the Financial Times or on NBC or CNBC, and they'd communicate and they'd reach a very large audience. Maybe only a fraction of that audience actually wanted to get that message, but they considered it worthwhile spending that money to advertise what they were doing in these major news organizations which reach such a large audience. Now, of course, we've had disintermediation. They don't need to do that anymore. The companies can reach audiences directly through social media, directly through the way in which they communicate directly to customers themselves. The role of the news organization in being that intermediary has been significantly diminished. And so what's happened? Advertising revenue has collapsed. advertising revenue, just to give you an illustration, print advertising revenue, the core source of revenue for newspapers in the United States for 100 plus years, has in the last 10 years fallen by 65%. It's the kind of collapse in revenue in a business that you associate with the termination of a business. You don't see that kind of decline and expect a business to recover from it. And even more scary, another statistic I like to quote is that even after that decline, advertising still accounts for, print newspaper advertising still accounts for a disproportionate amount of companies' spend. Companies, people actually spend now roughly less than 10% of their time looking at print products. They actually still, the companies still spend 20% of their budgets advertising in print products. So we can expect over time print advertising revenues to fall even further. Now this is literally, I was going to say decimated, of course it's dramatically more than decimated, it's fundamentally undermined the revenues of every commercial news organization, particularly newspapers, because it's hit print advertising revenue particularly hard, in the country and in the world. And it has, fundamentally destroyed the business model on which business journalism functioned for so long. So what is the answer? Does business journalism just disappear? In many cases, unfortunately, yes, that's true. Many news organizations are cutting back dramatically on the amount of coverage of business news, the serious business news that the world increasingly relies on, they're cutting it back. Newspapers, you'll see it in all newspapers, non-specialized newspapers in particular, they used to have significant business sections, they don't anymore. They simply can't afford to sustain that kind of expense in journalism. They've cut back. Major business news organizations have themselves also been in retreat. Again, we at the Wall Street Journal have lost a significant amount of advertising revenue. We've actually invested in our journalism, and I'll come to that in a second, but we have seen a significant decline in advertising revenue. So have the other major financial news organizations in the world. So how do we square this circle? How do we meet this growing demand for financial news, for business news, for quality news, while we face this continuing, and it is continuing, relentless decline in our core source of revenue? The answer, I think, I hope, because otherwise I won't have a job if I'm wrong, is we at the Journal believe, which is that actually the future of business journalism, of quality business journalism, lies in actually developing an alternative business model. And that's what we're in the process of doing. Now, there are some who argue, well, in order to do good journalism, you know, journalism isn't going to pay. We've seen this, that old model of advertising essentially subsidizing the activities of journalists to go out and find stories. It's just no longer there. So we need to find some other way of subsidizing them. Maybe it's through government. People have talked about maybe there's government should pay for journalism. I'm thoroughly opposed to that. I think the idea of government funding journalism is the equivalent of putting, as somebody put it, Dracula in charge of a blood bank. I think that would be incredibly damaging to free speech and to freedom of journalism. Others have talked about, well, maybe we need to rely on philanthropic efforts. And of course, there is some of that. More and more journalism is being funded that way. And that's great. And I think it's good that people do that. But I don't think that's a sustainable model either. What we're trying to do, and I think this is the model, is we believe that actually there is a demand for business journalism, and as I've said, and that actually instead of financing it through advertising, it can be financed through direct payment by people who actually want to consume that business journalism. And that is the subscriber base. So we at the Wall Street Journal have dramatically increased the number of subscribers. We were the first in 1996, you will may or may not know, to charge people for digital access to our journalism. Everybody else back in 1996, every other newspaper in the world pretty well decided to put their news on the web then as it was for free. The Journal, the leaders of the Journal, business leaders of the Journal, with great foresight, said they weren't going to do that. They thought that was the route to suicide. So they would actually charge people. And that's the way that the Journal developed, growing its circulation, growing its subscriber base in that direction, steadily replacing advertising revenue. Now, I can't pretend that we are replacing all of the advertising revenue lost. We haven't done that. But I firmly believe that that's the way in which we can grow and we can continue to generate the kind of revenues that are necessary to sustain quality business journalism. It means providing journalism that people actually, and this I think is one of the important characteristics of modern and future business journalism, it means providing a lot of business journalism that will be more of, if you like, more of a service orientation. As I said, there is a large hunger for business news, for business information around the world, and we have an ability to provide that. Much of that will be in the form of telling people what's happening in companies, in the stock market, in the global economy, and all of the related business around that. And people will, there is a clear evidence, we've demonstrated it, other newspapers have demonstrated it too, that there is a market for that. People are willing to pay for that information. And at the same time, we can of course generate enough revenue to do the kind of deep, hard-hitting journalism that is really necessary to make sure that the global economy, the market economy is functioning effectively, that information is freely available, that people really understand what's going on in companies. So it's a moment of both extraordinary opportunity and extraordinary challenge for journalism in general. There's no question about that. You'll all have been studying that, no doubt, and seeing what's been happening to journalism, but obviously for business journalism too. And in the end, I think it comes down to whether or not you believe journalism is purely has a social function, is purely there to improve governance, to improve the operation of civil society, whether it's a public good, if you like. Of course, there are elements of that which are true, and that's been a fundamental feature of much journalism for a very long time. Or whether you believe journalism actually can be sustained as on a business basis, as a business model, and whether or not you can create a market for people who are willing to pay for business journalism in order both to provide them with an extraordinarily valuable public service, which is information, financial information, but also to give them the kind of deeper and more, if you like, more difficult information, the kind of investigations, the kind of deeper reporting that's needed. So I'm optimistic. I remain very optimistic about the future of journalism. I look around and I see lots of, at the Wall Street Journal, we have lots and lots of people coming in every year who still want to do journalism, who are still motivated primarily by that desire to tell the truth, to find out what's going on, to expose it, to expose corruption, wrongdoing, to make people accountable for their actions. And I think there will continue to be a powerful need for that in any society, certainly in a market economy, certainly in an economy like ours, which is very vibrant and very dynamic, but which needs to be, which needs the light of day to expose some of the things that go on. And I think that we have a way of doing that. And I would argue that we have a business model for the future that enables us to do it. So thank you very much indeed for listening. I am now very happy to hand it over for the panel.
The grill.
So I'm going to put you in the second seat there. So why don't you come up as I introduce you all. I want to tell you one thing as we have our panel come up. Chelsea Delaney, class of 14, graduated last May. Proud to say she's at the Wall Street Journal. She's had a couple of front page articles. So we are continuing to populate it. And one of the early editors, Chris Rausch, has written the biography of Vermont Royster. He was a professor here in the journalism school. He was one of the modern architects of the Wall Street Journal. Now, you think this just broke at that moment. Did you notice he was talking about the internet when the internet went down, or our pictures, or we started having Adobe? Part of what's made business journalism of such interest is that our world has changed. You want to know about Zuckerberg, don't you? I mean, who is this guy who started Facebook and the people behind Twitter? That is all now part of this whole economic story and the business story. So the world has changed also to be of particular interest, because it's particularly people in your generation who are doing startups and new business ventures and entrepreneurism that is making this a really vital part of the American story. So let me introduce you to our our panelists, who are now going to, as we say, we're going to grill. We're going to show what we know, only we're starting not with a journalism professor, but Dan Gitterman is the Thomas Willis Lambeth Distinguished Chair in Public Policy here at UNC Chapel Hill. And he runs our public policy school, and they are one of the ones sponsoring tonight. He is really interested in that intersection between journalism and public policy and brings students to Washington every year so they can experience it directly. He's also a fantastic teacher, won the Tanner Award, which is one of the most esteemed awards you can win here on campus. And for those of you who don't know what this is, write it down and look it up on the internet later. He won in 2013 the Order of the Longleaf Pine. That is a big deal, only given by the governor of the state, and I was there when you got it. So Dan is going to lead us in this discussion. Andy Willard, over there on the right, is a senior broadcasting journalism major. That's why Nelson Benton would also be very happy. He is a major from Jamestown, North Carolina. He's also been a staff writer for the Daily Tar Heel. He's been a reporter for the Carolina Connection, which is the radio show that we do every week. So he is working on all platforms, thank goodness, because we want you to be very nimble. I think you'll also find this intriguing. This summer, he had an internship in New York, and he worked for a very large advertising firm called the Y&R firm, and he fell in love. He found it really intriguing because he saw strategy work, and if he's successful, someday Bojangles will be a national brand, not just in the South. And Nelson Benton would like that too, Andy.
Absolutely.
And our last questioner is Sarah Headley. She is a senior. She lives outside of Charlotte when she's not here, and she too is one of those cross-platform people. She's studying, majoring in political science, but she's minoring in journalism. She likes that intersection. She also writes for a publication that is focused on local startups, and she is working at the radio station where Charles Carroll began, WCHL. She's also been on the Daily Tar Heel staff and worked on the university desk. She's in love with history and with our basketball team. I'm happy to say we started out pretty good this year. So with that, Dan, you're in charge.
Thank you, Dean King.
Show what we've got here the school. Make it tough. One last thing. Rupert Murdoch. How many of you know the name Rupert Murdoch? Yeah. Rupert Murdoch bought the Wall Street Journal 5-6 years ago.
7 years ago.
7 years ago. And there was great gnashing of teeth in some circles because he is a very notorious newsman. He'd been a very successful newsman, a very successful businessman. And when they did the merger, when they sold it, the family sold it to Murdoch, they got a special committee that was set up that the family who sold it would be members of this committee along with the board of the Wall Street Journal. They would decide who would be the editor-in-chief going forward because they wanted to make sure it was someone good. Jerry was the one they picked a couple of years ago, the two of them together. I think that's a moment of distinction. So, you've
got it. Thank you, Dean King. Our plan will be to turn things over to the student journalists and hopefully allow for some times for, and questions for, from the audience. And so my mic will be your mic, and we'll take some questions. Jerry, I also need to thank you for not wearing a tie. My family voted this morning, and they all said that if the editor-in-chief of the Wall Street Journal is coming, you ought to wear a suit and tie. And I said, I hate ties. And Jerry, you have no idea how much easier it is for me to go home tonight and tell them that he didn't wear a tie either.
I'm wearing a suit, though, so you've got a little bit of way to go.
Thank you. So let's turn things over to our panelist, and you're on.
Okay. So Jerry, one of the things you talked about is how business journalism in the past 25 years has become one of the most prominent types of journalism, one of the most important, so important that people are willing to go through these paywalls for it. How has that affected other areas of coverage, like you talked about political coverage and military coverage?
Yeah, that's a good question. There's, again, I think business journalism is something that people perceive a need to pay for, so they will subscribe because it provides them with valuable financial information. The other journalism, the rest, everything else that we do, and by the way, I should also say at the Wall Street Journal, even as we've even as we've expanded our business journalism, we've also expanded lots into lots of other areas too. We cover sports now in a way that we never did. We've even written about North Carolina sports, I have to say. And I don't say even cover them. We've covered them in great detail, particularly basketball. But we cover sports, we cover entertainment, we cover art, and obviously we cover all of the things you talk about, politics, wars, diplomacy, international relations, all of that kind of stuff. The answer is that actually, and by the way, I can tell you that you know, and we track this very closely, and we can track closely the reasons that people subscribe to the Wall Street Journal. We can tell when someone reads a story or tries to read a story which they have to pay, which they have to subscribe to, which they have to subscribe to the journal in order to read. We can tell what those stories are, and we know that the ones that drive most subscribers are business stories, finance stories, economic stories. So what I say to our staff and more broadly is, look, it's very important, even though these business stories are the ones that drive circulation and the ones that people are willing to pay for, it's also very important that they understand the context. So, you know, again, you don't have to be narrowly focused on the business side, business and economics, to understand that what's going on in the Middle East right now, what's just happened in the midterm elections in Washington, what's happening in Europe, what's happening actually even more broadly than that, if you like, in cultural and other fields, matters to a readership that is focused on business. So although they don't directly drive subscriptions as much as business news does, the evidence is that they're very well read. A lot of people actually want to read them. By the way, opinion is incredibly important. The Wall Street Journal has a very strong conservative editorial page, and people want to pay in order, will subscribe in order to read that. So it's important to have the context, the overall context in which these really important economic events are taking place. And in order to do that, you've got to have that broader journalism too.
So a really interesting article that I found earlier by Christopher Mims, and it was talking about how apps are kind of taking over the web. Mm. I know he said in the article that when the web first launched, it didn't really have a set structure, and apps are more structured, and there's more control over those.
Right.
So how do you see that in the next 10 years? Where do you think the web will be? Where do you think apps will be? And how do you think the Wall Street Journal will be a part of that?
So we already obviously have apps for mobile devices. We have a very strong and iPad app right now, which we just relaunched, which is a significant amount of our total subscribers use the iPad app. We're just about to relaunch our smartphone apps, both for iOS and for Android. We'll be launching a new specifically targeted app, a slightly different type of product called What's News. We'll be launching that in the course of the next couple of months. So we are, and we'll do, we others too, we have a video app and we have various other things. So we're absolutely, we understand the way in which people are consuming media is increasingly on mobile devices, and obviously that increasingly they want to consume that through apps. I think, you know, the Christopher Mims column that he wrote that appeared actually today, I think is, you know, does however raise that question, which is the old, if you like, the old web, and it seems such a strange thing to talk in terms of the old web when it's only 20 odd years old, but the old web was a more open, was as people have described it, more of a kind of a down the rabbit hole kind of phenomenon, right? You go to a website and you'd find yourself, you know, linking to other websites and find yourself going all over the web, and you know, before you know where you are, you've lost your entire day, and you know, you haven't got that essay written or you haven't done that important piece of work. But the serendipity of exploring the web that came about, I think, through webs rather than apps, I think is being lost steadily. And I think that's, you know, that is just, however, inevitable. I mean, I think that, you know, what are there, 800,000 apps already available for iOS. I think there are more than that now available for Android. So, you know, it's not as though there's any shortage, though, of opportunity for people to access information. But what I think it does do, and by the way, I think crucially what apps do, is they do make it easier for news organizations or any content organization to get people to pay for what they're providing, because that people are going to focus on the, if you like, it's more of a vertical approach. They're going to look at the content in that app, and if they like it, they're going to decide they're going to pay for it. It's an easy way to get them to subscribe. But I think Christopher's right. I think it does cut off to some extent some of that broader web, and I think it does limit some of the kind of exploration that one used to have through exploring the web.
So one of the things you keep touching on is how the digital, sort of this digital era has changed journalism. And I don't know if you know this, but we're required to take an ethics class for our coursework. And one of the things we've discussed is how companies are sort of mining this digital data for information on the people who are using their products. Right. And we sort of like get into these discussions about what are proper uses for it and what's not. And so at the Wall Street Journal, when you're tracking what people are reading and how they're reading it, what are the policies on collecting data on them and who's in those conversations?
We have very strict rules. We don't collect any data on what individuals are actually, what individuals are doing, so from either from the business perspective or from the news perspective. If an individual registers and subscribes to the Wall Street Journal, obviously we can then contact that, you know, have a relationship with that person. But we don't collect data. So for example, we don't collect any information, and this has been a controversial issue in some, for some news organizations. We don't have access to any of the data that any user of the Wall Street Journal, what they're doing outside, what they're looking at the Wall Street Journal. So we can see, obviously, if they've read a story about the midterm elections or about what happened in the stock market, and again, let me come back to this, but so we are separated, the business side and the news side. The business side can trace within the journal whether what those people have read, so they can say, they can then tailor to that subscriber who's already obviously provided his or her information to the journal, well, you know, you like this story, you might like this story. It's that kind of approach. We on the news side have no access to that information at all. So none of my editors can pursue a particular story with a view to a particular reader in mind. We don't operate like that. But we have very strong rules about the way in which information can be used. Some news organizations have had some controversies, as you probably know, where their journalists have actually been able to have access to information about what their customers are accessing in terms, you know, Bloomberg had a particularly infamous issue recently where, you know, as you know, the Bloomberg terminal companies subscribe to Bloomberg, they pay a lot of money, they get access to all kinds of information, financial information, they have access to chat rooms and that kind of stuff. And normally there's supposed to be, and in Bloomberg's case, there was supposed to be a very strict wall between the information, the business side, what these customers are doing with their business, and the news side, the people who report on it. That wall at one point rather broke down. We have a very, very strict rule about what can be accessed.
So in another recent article, there was a lot of coverage on ISIS and the recent beheading. And earlier this year, there was an American journalist who was also beheaded. So there was a lot of controversy on whether to post that video earlier this year. How do you decide whether it's newsworthy enough or where to cut the line on that?
It's a very difficult judgment you have to make, because on the one hand, it's clearly newsworthy. It's clearly a horrific event, which clearly is going to have and did have an enormous influence on the policy of the US government. It was a very significant part of the reason why President Obama and the British government and the French government and most of the many other governments decided to launch airstrikes against in Iraq in particular, and in the US case actually to launch some attacks in Syria. So it was hugely important, and again it was the emotive effect of that those beheadings, I think, that had a very important influence. At the same time, you have to weigh that against the question: are you providing propaganda? Are you unnecessarily providing propaganda for people in whatever they do? By the way, this doesn't just apply to terrorists, but it could apply to all kinds of groups. And so you want to be very careful. And we think about this all the time. It applies to videos like that. We decided not to show that video. We thought there are issues of taste associated with it, obviously, and just how horrific it was. But B, and more importantly, it was because we felt it would be these terrorists had essentially done this precisely for the purpose of getting that video aired as far and wide as they could, and we thought we weren't going to do that. Just as, by the way, if a company you know, did something, produced a video or produced something that was clearly designed to promote its interests, we would think very, very hard before publishing that. And generally speaking, we wouldn't, unless there was some really, really powerful news interest in doing it. So we have to be very, very careful in weighing the news value versus the impact, versus whether or not we are serving somebody else's propaganda cause. And in those cases, and in most cases, we are very careful to avoid promoting propaganda.
Joe, I want you to take a look out at all the technology out there.
Yep.
And just know that while you are having great pleasure as they read the Wall Street Journal and Facebook.
Which I'm sure they're all doing right now.
That's right. We who teach are absolutely tortured by technology. We fear they're not with us. Let me ask a question before we open it up on the floor. Large number of future Wall Street Journal employees here. When you look at a resume, when they present themselves, what do you need to hear? What tells you this is a smart, well-rounded journalist who should work at the Wall Street Journal?
I think most of all, curiosity, I would say, is that to me, that's the most important quality that a good journalist is, that unites all good journalists. They need to be curious, by which I don't mean they need to be strange, although quite a lot of journalists are curious in that sense of the term too, but they need to have a very heightened sense of interest in the world around them. They want to know what's happening in the Middle East, or they want to know what Apple is going to do with its next products and why it's going in a direction with a watch rather than some other wearable. They have a hunger to learn about what companies are doing, what governments are doing, what individuals are doing. It's that more than anything, and that, to be honest with you, if you have that curiosity, you know, obviously there are certain minimum academic standards, which of course everybody at the University of North Carolina would satisfy, I have absolutely no doubt whatsoever. You need to be able to write. You need to be able to be reasonably numerate. You need to be able to be fairly gregarious and outgoing and make sure that you're able to communicate with people. But I think it is the defining and the unifying feature is curiosity and a desire to learn more about the world and a refusal to accept, which is part of the same thing, a refusal to accept what you're told. One of my best friends in journalism, who sadly died a few years ago, used to say that the reason he went into journalism is because he didn't trust anything he read in the newspapers. And I think that's part of what, you know, it's you read a lot, you see a lot, you're all looking at, probably spending hours and hours a day looking at Facebook and looking at Twitter and looking at news sites and other sites. You're being told all kinds of information. You really want to know what's really going on. A lot of that information is good and helpful, but you have a hunger to know what's really going on behind those stories that you're being told. And that's what I think is most attractive about a really good quality journalist.
We're going to go to the floor now. We have about maybe 10, 12 minutes. And so if you would just raise your hand, I will come find you. Identify yourself real briefly, and then we'll take your question.
Hiya. I'm Brittany Jordan. I'm a photojournalism major and a Policy 101 alumni. So I was looking at the Life and Style section of the Wall Street Journal, and I was curious as to why the Wall Street Journal was covering fashion in a vein similar to Vogue and Harper's Bazaar, when fashion as a business grosses more than music, movies, and books combined every year, and why you weren't looking at it from more of a market and business perspective, and why you were looking and reporting more in a high fashion trend sort of way.
I mean, it's an interesting, I'm not sure, I think I'd challenge you a bit on that. I mean, we have a magazine, a monthly magazine, which appears obviously in print and in digital format, where we cover, which is heavily about fashion, not exclusively about fashion, but it's heavily about fashion. And we cover fashion in other parts of the paper too. We cover it both as a business, but you're right, we cover it as a consumer feature too. So people want to know about, you know, what is hot in the latest fashion shows. But I think we do, so we did make a conscious decision to cover fashion more, partly because it was an opportunity for us to reach, we made the decision 5 or 6 years ago that the journal needed to reach a broader audience. If I tell you that the journal's audience, the journal's traditional readership is extremely, was in the past, very male, and very old, and very wealthy. So it was fine for people like me, except for the wealthy part. It was my age group and my ethnicity and my gender, but we weren't reaching a lot of people who looked different from me. And so we really made a big push into all kinds of areas, arts and entertainment. Fashion was very important in that respect too. But I think we also do cover arts and entertainment. Every Friday we have a section called Arena, which covers movies, theater, music in great detail. We cover all those things again on Saturdays in particular, and we cover them as a news story throughout the week. So I take your point. We do, you know, we have focused a lot on fashion in the last few years, but I would also urge you to read, you know, the rest of what's in the journal, because we cover those other issues in a lot of depth too.
Other questions?
I'll take your computer, you stand up.
Oh, I needed to ask my question though.
Here you go.
Thank you. Very much appreciate you coming. My question is around what you were talking about earlier in terms of modernizing and trying to become leaner. You know, in the past week, you announced some cutbacks in certain areas, including the Wall Street Journal radio network. Can you talk about and elaborate on what your sort of core interests are and where those core interests are not, and sort of identify how you're making the determinations about what you want to continue to do better and what you are trying to leave behind?
Thank you for the question. It's a good question, and it feeds directly back to what I said in my remarks, which is that we believe that if journalism is going to survive, and I believe it is, and thrive, then it does need to develop a new model. And the model needs to be subscription-based. We need to go out and we need to get as many people as we can around the world to pay for a subscription to the Wall Street Journal, which, you know, costs for most people roughly $30 a month. That is going, if we can do that, and if we can significantly increase the number of subscribers we have, we will replace the revenue that we've lost from advertising, from print advertising in particular, and we'll have a sustainable business model going forward. So the decision we made, the company made, when we, as we looked at this and we've developed a strategy, was we should focus our efforts, you know, in a world of constrained resources, we should focus our efforts on those parts of what we do that are going to most likely to generate subscriptions for the Wall Street Journal. So we've taken a hard look at everything we do in the US and around the world. And we're a big news organization. We have 1,800 journalists, you know, way bigger than, say, the New York Times, bigger than most television newsrooms. We're a very large news organization. But we have to focus our journalists, our resources, our editors, our reporters, on those parts of what we do that are going to actually feed directly into more and more people subscribing to the Wall Street Journal. So the very difficult decisions we had to take last week, where we closed some of the things we did, were based entirely on that principle, that we felt that those parts were not as likely to contribute to people subscribing to the journal as some of the other things we do. But that will be our lodestar going forward, increasing circulation, increasing the number of subscribers in order to generate the revenue that enables us to do the journalism that we think is necessary.
Hi, my name is Will Scheffler. I wanted to thank you for coming. It was a great talk. I wanted to see what you thought. Obviously advertising is a big like revenue builder for not just newspapers, but also for other websites like Facebook, YouTube. Do you think that other websites are going to follow the same subscription-based model that you have? And what do you think that that's going to mean for the future of advertising, especially people who might be advertising majors in here?
It's another good question. I think the simple answer, because I think the problem is that the newspaper model the newspaper advertising-based model was fundamentally an anachronism. That is, the way in which newspapers operated for 100 years was that they would expand their reach, their circulation as far as they could, and newsstand sales and everything else. They would pursue the journalism, and they would sell product, or they would, on behalf of their advertisers, sell products there. Advertisers would put, a full-page advertisement in the Wall Street Journal to sell a car or a financial instrument or something like that. A tiny fraction of readers would actually even care about that, and a smaller fraction than that would actually act on it. But that was broadly that would just about justify the marketing expense. With the digital, with the onset of the digital model, first of all, advertisers can much more efficiently, I hate to say it, much more efficiently advertise what they do, because they can target people for a start. It's much easier to target. You don't have to we have 2.5 million circulation print of the Wall Street Journal. You don't have to pay for, which is very expensive, a full page ad in the Wall Street Journal to get the 5,000 people out of those 2.5 million you might be wanting to do. You can target it. You have tremendous data available from what people are doing, whether it's on Facebook or Google or wherever else. You can target those people. Secondly, the kind of advertising that I think that is thriving, whether it's on places like Google or Facebook, to some extent Twitter isn't doing quite as well, is very focused on the kind of consumers they want. So if you know how it works. If you do a Google search, you're searching for pizza, then you will get immediately, you're searching for pizza in Chapel Hill, the first thing that will come up on your Google search will be an ad for a pizza place in Chapel Hill, and it will be incredibly effective. That is a very, very effective way of advertising. For a national newspaper, we can't provide that level of specificity and targeting. If you go to the Wall Street Journal website, we advertise again. We're still advertising for a larger audience, a much larger audience than that. Even if we can target it to some extent by knowing where people are, that's not the targeted search-based advertising or the targeted social-based advertising that Google or in the latter case Facebook can do. So the advertising model can definitely work. It's going to be much more efficient, much more targeted, and much more focused. And social search and some other content providers, if you like, are going to benefit from that. We'll still have advertising. I mean, don't get me wrong. The journal will still be a model, a channel for people to reach an audience. But it just won't be as effective a model as some of those other products.
We've got time for one more question over here. You've got the mic.
Hi, my name is Sofia La Guardia. I'm a broadcast journalism major. I'm pretty sure all the journalists here can agree that one of the hardest things about journalism is maintaining an objective perspective. And with the Wall Street Journal being an openly conservative paper, where do you find the line lies between having a conservative opinion and a conservative bias?
A conservative opinion and what was the last word?
What's the difference between having a conservative opinion and a conservative bias?
Bias. So let me stress, you're right, the Wall Street Journal is renowned for being a conservative paper, but that's its editorial pages. The journal has a very, very strict divide between its editorial pages and its news pages. The editor of the editorial pages, who is a very prominent, very intelligent, and significant figure in conservative circles, doesn't report to me. I don't report to him. We both report separately in the business structure to the chief executive. I don't influence what goes on his pages, and he doesn't have any influence over what goes on my pages. It's literally two separate structures, two separate teams, two separate groups. We are in the same building, but there's a kind of, virtual wall between the two of us. We socialize. I like him. He's a very nice guy, but we don't have any professional communication between us. So that's the editorial page, and they are very conservative and very successful at what they do. On the news pages, We do play it straight. We do. We believe in, especially in financial journalism, the importance of striving to be objective. And let me stress, striving to be objective. No one is ever going to be perfectly objective. No one ever has the ability to see 360 degrees on every single issue. So of course, we're not always going to be right. But if we demonstrate repeatedly a willingness to tell the story, and we have very strong rules about this. We have editors, specific editors whose job it is, the standards editors, to ensure that when we cover a political story, to make sure that different sides are represented in that story, to make sure that it's not an opinionated piece, that it's not expressing a view. And so we work very, very hard to do that because we believe it's really important for our readers who, you know, some of them will like the conservative editorial pages, and that's great, and some of them, many people subscribe to the Wall Street Journal specifically for that reason, and that's terrific.
That's not me. I'm sorry.
But the news pages, we need to keep straight, we need to keep objective, we need to keep fair, as objective as we can. And look, I would just cite, don't just trust me for saying it, I would cite there was a very interesting study done by the Pew Research Organization just a couple of months ago, which did a massive study of readers and viewers of news organizations in the United States. The Wall Street Journal, they looked at something like 45 news organizations. The Wall Street Journal was the only news organization that was more trusted than distrusted by every single group along the political spectrum. Extreme liberals, moderate liberals, centrists, moderate conservatives, and extreme conservatives. The only one, you can actually go to the Pew website, you can look it up and see it there. We were the only one of the 45 news organizations that were more trusted than distrusted by people of all ideological persuasions. And I'm very proud of that because that's what we strive to do and that's what we should do. And so that's the way to earn the trust of all readers and to make sure that people are going to come back to you because they think they can trust what you're doing.
Please join me in thanking your colleague and student panelist and Jerry Baker.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Jerry, the mug is yours about Carolina.
And I know there's a bit of a football game going on Thursday, so I'm sure that I'll be supporting the right team this
year. That is. There's only one school in the area. thank you all very much. Good night.
Thank you.